I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Staying up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright with my TV guidance counselor.
Hello everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, the on hiatus Boston stand-up comedian who welcomes an interesting guest virtually into my home each and every week to discuss classic television using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway to our collective past. And this week my guest is just an awesome dude. Thanks to Alison Rosen for hooking me up with this guest. If you are already a fan of RJ's, I know he has a ton, and you're checking out this show for the first time, welcome. I think you will like this show. This is a little match made in heaven here. RJ is a wrestler. He does a show every Sunday, an AEW show on Sunday mornings called Hey EW, EW on the YouTube channel for AEW. He has an amazing YouTube channel himself, which is RJ City Loves You. I put links in the description of this show and also on the social media. He's at RJ City One on Twitter. If you don't follow him, do. If you like this show, you will like the things he puts out. I know that may sound strange, given that he's best known for being a wrestler, but trust me, it's very simpatico here. I had a great time talking to him. If you, like Alison Rosen, have suggestions for people that you'd like to have on the show or guests that you want me to try to get, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. Also, we have Patreon, patreon.com/tvguidancecounselor. For as little as $1 a month, you can be a massive help to the show. Also, I've been putting some video stuff up on there, little extra things here and there. If there's anything you would like me to put on the Patreon that would entice you to give a couple bucks to the show every month, let me know at the aforementioned email addresses I spouted out earlier. Anyway, enough of me. Let's get to me and RJ for this brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, RJ City.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Live via satellite, are you in Toronto?
Yes.
Oh, from Toronto, international satellite, RJ City, how are you?
Wonderful. How are you? I want to say thank you for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you for doing it.
Alison Rosen messaged me, and she said, do you want to do this podcast? And I skimmed the message of what it was. And before I even finished skimming, I said, yes, this is my kind of thing that I need to do. And even if this podcast is wonderful, the guest list, I'm very honored to be listed among these guests. But even if you had no one, I would be doing this.
You said that too. When I said, we'll get to the guide in a minute, but when I sent you this, you're like, oh, even if we didn't do this podcast, I would want to look through this TV guide.
I spent an inordinate amount of time. I did too much work. And I was happy to.
The too much work bar was set by John Sayles, the director, writer, director, who showed up and he had like an hour's worth of TV theme songs he had queued up. Like I was like, this is unnecessary, but thank you. So you might be a second, I'm going to say. There's nothing wrong with that, because that is an inhuman amount. But yeah, I was psyched to have you on because I watched your stuff and I was like, oh yeah, no, this, I said this before, but I'm like, this makes total sense. So you are, for people that don't know, you're a wrestler.
Yes.
So you're probably best known for that, but your YouTube channel has so much classic TV content stuff on there, equal to or almost more than the wrestling.
Yes, and I also want to say, if you saw me in wrestling, you would say, oh, I understand how this bleeds over. They just give him a live mic, and then he sings Ethel Mirman and gets booed. This somehow makes sense now. So I don't want to give the impression that I'm just angry and oily and
He's angry and oily, everybody. He it was weird before we started recording. He took his shirt off and rubbed down like Tim Capello in Lost Boys, just oiled up, and then it was really weird.
It helps me scroll.
Yeah.
But no, I wrestling to me, and this is the best way to look at it. If you're not familiar with it's a violent Muppet show.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
it's as a stand-up comedian, it's there's so many parallels. Mm-hmm. It's basically stand-up comics who are in shape.
Then it's such a they may look like they're in shape, but they're incredibly unhealthy.
Oh yes.
This is not a longevity shape.
Oh yes. No, I've met Jake the Snake Roberts. I've met Ravishing Rick Rude.
Where did you meet Ravishing Rick Rude?
Oh God, this story. I've told this on the show before, but I used to go to the Boston Garden once a month, would have tapings, and I would go all the time until I was about 10 and I kind of lost interest, but I would go all the time. And sometimes I would have panic attacks because I'm a picture of good mental health.
A crowd of people yelling obscenities.
Yeah.
So
yeah. And in Boston, no less. So you can imagine what the professional wrestling fan crowd was like in 1988 in the Boston Garden. Very tolerant people. So I had to leave early, and in the garden, there was like kind of no way to, there's like no back door. So if you were a performer and you were leaving, you kind of had to go through the lobby area where like the food vendors were. So I was leaving, and I think my uncle took me. I was waiting for him to go to the bathroom, and Ravishing Rick Rude was leaving. And literally this little kid in a wheelchair like wheels up to him, and he's like, "Oh, Mr. Rude, can I have your autograph?" And he goes, "Get out of my way, R word, or I'll kick you down those stairs." Staying in character.
Oh, man. Yep. And everyone went, there's a method actor.
Yep. Stayed in character for, I guess, just that kid because he didn't know I was there.
Yeah, that's a man who deserved an Emmy.
Yep. He's like, clearly. Man, I don't want to disappoint this kid.
Whoa. I have to now recalibrate where Rick Rude sits in my brain.
Higher or lower?
A little lower.
Okay.
I had to go, okay, let's just add that story into his file.
Yeah. Well, we also had the very first cable access show about wrestling was in Lynn, Massachusetts. Oh, it was called Wrestling Talk with Len. What was Len's last name? I don't remember Len's last name. Yeah, it was
just at a desk. Or?
Yes, just at a desk. Yeah. He started in like 1983. And so we used to have a lot of people come through. And of course, Killer Kowalski grew up half a mile from where I sit now.
Yes. Wow. A bizarre legacy.
It's a very strange legacy. Yeah. So I have met a few wrestlers in the past, but not nearly interacted as much as you have, I'm sure.
No. No, not at all. But yes, so it's this. I always take old show business. I'm passionate about it, and I always try to bring it into wrestling. That's like my great joy.
It is old show business. I mean, like there's a documentary. What's the? Oh my God, I forget the name. It's about women wrestlers. It's amazing. The
Lipstick and Dynamite.
Yes, Lipstick and Dynamite. And that essentially is a burlesque vaudeville documentary, mm-hmm. for the most part. Like, there's really no difference there. Yeah. Such a good documentary. And yeah, it was live entertainment. And I always say this on the show, it was the first sport televised was bowling and wrestling. You know, made sense because you lock down the cameras and you don't have to follow action. It's all right there. It's already set up. But yeah, it made sense. And they're intrinsically linked. The touring, the similar issues people suffer from, the being an onstage persona that's a little bit of yourself, but also not you really. Like, there's all those things are sort of mixed into that world, which is fascinating. But you grew up in Toronto, like outside Toronto?
Yeah, like just north of Toronto. It is Toronto. It's,
okay.
Yeah.
Because there's not, I mean, maybe I'm completely wrong here, but the only other Canadian wrestler I can think of is Rowdy Roddy Piper.
I mean, Bret Hart.
Okay.
Chris Jericho, Agent Christian, Iron Mike Sharp, Canada's greatest athlete. But Canada has a bubble to it, like Canadian entertainment, where you have to kind of break free of it. It's a little difficult, but there is a tremendous amount of wrestling in Canada. There's a tremendous amount of wrestling in Ontario because Ontario's so big.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know? And before they started shooting everything in Vancouver, like American shows and all that stuff, like Ontario was sort of the not quite the Hollywood of Canada, but sort of Hollywood mixed with New York.
Hollywood North.
Yeah.
It's what they like to say. It's what they once alleged about.
Well, they would allege that back in the tax shelter days, which brought us all the David Cronenberg movies.
Correct. Absolutely. And weren't they fun?
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, no, wrestling in Canada is the same. Like I always say, because America has more of everything. So America has better wrestling and also worse wrestling.
Yes, that's true of literally numbers. Of everything. Yeah, better and
absolutely
worse of
everything. Or you have more flavors of Oreos. So you have some that are better and then you have some that are worse.
A lot that are bad, but an interesting novelty.
Right. And then Canada has like three flavors. We got like the double stuffed and the golden ones and like
and that's ketchup.
It. Yes. Take your pick. That's it.
I'm surprised there's not a poutine or a ketchup Oreo, like some kind of savory Canadian Oreo.
Don't give this out.
That's a million dollar
disgusting
idea.
And it needs to stop.
I'm surprised they haven't because Kraft Dinner went, this is totally off topic, but that's fine. Kraft Dinner like went full on Canada, like we're gonna just release like limited edition crazy flavors so we can get like, you know, I think they had like a bubblegum flavor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we didn't get that
it's
here.
Not, there was some sick factory thing that they realized, like, oh, we can just mix these and that'll be fine. And it's just wrong.
I feel like it's someone totally who's like, wrong. I fucked up. They're like, what'd you do? I don't know. It kind of tastes like bubblegum, though. All right, fine. I know what we'll do. I got an idea.
I always said that, like, the fact that they could make a Dorito that tasted like a cheeseburger tells you that there's a problem with the North American cheeseburger. Like, that's not a flavor that should be captured in a chip.
No, that shouldn't be in powder form. Yeah, that's a problem. So when you're growing up, though, like how, because I think you're younger than me, like how did you get into not only old showbiz, and I'm asking for a specific reason people know in a moment, but also specifically old wrestling, which presumably is what kind of steered you into doing it yourself?
It was always like, I will blame my grandmother for getting me into old show business. She would sit me down and make me watch like an Abbott and Costello or, oh my God, you know, Charlie Chan?
Yes. Oh yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. And just like, oh, watch this stuff. This is stuff I loved when I was, you know, younger. So I would watch it and I would assume like, this is what everyone was watching. No one was watching this at all. And, you know, then I go to school and go, hey, you know, Laurel and Hardy, did you guys see Marks of the Wooden Soldiers? No, what are you talking about?
Catch that Harold Lloyd yesterday?
That would always, you know, send me down this road. It just got in my brain. And I guess when my brain was softest, it was molded that way. And then, like, you're kind of, like, stuck. And then wrestling, I always just loved. I don't remember not loving it. And then the further you go back in wrestling, the more you realize like, oh, the stuff happening now isn't that original. There's you know, crazy, weird people back then, too. Obviously, like a Gorgeous George. You know,
yes.
Who was really on the same level as a Milton Berle in terms of television and people knowing him and whatever. So you just get sucked into it. By the way, can I throw this out to you? Because you seem like you may be able to help me. There is an episode of the Mike Douglas Show I am looking for.
Okay.
In it, Mike Douglas teams with a wrestler against, I believe, like Jerry Lewis and Andre the Giant.
Okay.
It's an outdoor, it's a ring on a beach.
Okay.
There are pictures, there are clips. I have been unable to find the full episode.
I will put out the call to my listeners, and I'll also send some emails out to my my archive people. There's very few things we haven't been able to find, so I will do my best to find it.
For some reason, this is my holy grail, only for me.
As soon as you said the Mike Douglas Show, all I could think of was that episode where John Michael Thor came out and sang that song by The Sweet and then exploded a hot water bottle. Have you ever seen that footage?
Yes.
He's in like a cape and underwear and he's like, yeah, it's pretty amazing.
And why don't we talk about the Mike Douglas Show more when it had that going on and so much Mason Reese?
Yeah, you can never have enough Mason Reese. I just assume Mason Reese was in every episode of the Mike Douglas Show. Also, that show was on. It wasn't a late night show. This was like a 2 p.m. show. So you got like Mason Reese, who's like 16, sitting on a panel, and then an oiled up Canadian bodybuilder comes out with a hammer and a cape and singing glam rock songs. And then you might have like a cooking segment with, Joan Rivers.
And Mike was equally as interested in every single person.
Yeah, of course. I do miss the true broadcasting talk shows where you'd have just a crazy mix of people. There clearly weren't pre-interviews. You know, it was just like, oh, whatever.
You'd catch people in different moods.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And they wouldn't care, too. Like, it wouldn't be like, oh, if I'm an asshole on this episode, like, my career's over. They would just be like, I gotta do this dumb thing. So you might get, like, there's an amazing episode of The Dinosaur Show. And the two guests for the whole episode are Iggy Pop and David Bowie. And it's online. You can watch from, like, 76. And Iggy Pop is wearing a suit but no shirt. Like just like a nice suit and no shirt and pants. And he's being like, well, he's like very polite Jim Osterberg. And Dinah Shore's like, I read somewhere that you cut yourself up with glass. Well, that's right. I did do that. And she's like, why'd you do that? Well, I was very unhappy at the time. Like, it's just this real. And then David Bowie's clearly coked up, but is like, oh, Jim's a genius. Like, it's just the weirdest thing.
And then I love like that Dinah era of just let's go on with the show.
Yeah.
Nothing will flap me.
Whoever they threw at her as a guest, like, we got to have Andy Kaufman, but he's dressed up as this other character. Okay.
Yes.
Whatever.
And isn't Charles Nelson Reilly in that episode too?
Yes. Yes. As if you needed more big people in that episode. Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. God. And I think that was Charles Nelson Reilly at the height of his Ghost and Mrs. Muir. Was it Ghost and Mrs. Muir fame? That show he was in?
Lidsville?
Not Lidsville. It was a show about a woman. She was either a divorcee or a widower, and she moved to Maine. And there was the ghost of a dead sea captain that lived in the house with her.
And oh, yes. I remember hearing
Charles Nelson Reilly's like a local schemer. He's kind of the wacky neighbor, but he's also kind of an asshole. It's very, very strange. And also every episode they write him being really into chicks, which is really funny because God's a good actor, but nope.
But wasn't that always the implicit joke?
I always wonder if it was the joke or because I've asked people about this before. Who are older than us who are around because I'm like, I'm reading these TV guides. There's like an article about Liberace trying to find the right girl. Like, people weren't just like, come on. And
I always, for my birthday once, David Arquette got me a cameo from Ruth Buzzi. And she was so, so sweet. She took so much time and like looked up my stuff and I got all emotional. It was weird. And she said, you know, David said, oh, you loved Charles Nelson Reilly. And she said, oh, I'm sure he would have loved you. And I'm like, wait a minute. You knew?
Yeah. But like, of course, everyone, they had to. But there are a lot of people who have told me they're like, well, you didn't. If you asked someone or they said they weren't, you were like, oh, yeah. Well, they said they're not. Like Paul Lynn, they're like, no, but. No, it's just, I guess people question things less then, but I'm sure the showbiz people were like, yeah, I mean, come on. You know, it's obvious for us now. Lidsville. Oh man. What a weird, is that your, what's your favorite Sid and Marty Kroft?
Probably Lidsville.
Yeah.
It's so ridiculous. Although Sid and Marty, I'm more obsessed with their world, their failed amusement park.
Yeah, with the giant pinball machine.
Which was at the CNN Center.
Yes.
Which is, it's a CNN Center now, and they have that big glass elevator they have is from that. And I will sometimes sit and daydream about what it must have been like.
Because it did open. Like, people, it existed. Like, not for a long time, but it existed.
No.
And I think,
and every level was a different world. It sounded like the best.
The best worst thing. Terrifying. I'm not a big amusement park fan, and that I would be like, that sounds amazing. I think someone will correct me on this, but I think it part of the closing was something in the lawsuit with McDonald's was because McDonald's ripped off HR Puff and stuff.
Yes, as they also ripped off Bozo the Clown.
Yes. Both bozos, the Boston and Chicago bozos.
Yes.
And they lost the lawsuit, but it was settled. And I think as part of the settlement, Sid and Marty Kroft had to basically like shut the fuck up about it and also not have rival, because those shows weren't airing anymore. Like they weren't making new episodes of Puff and stuff. I think that has something to do with the thing closing, but I might be totally wrong. And I know someone will correct me. I'm not. Because you picked, the reason I asked about old showbiz especially is because you picked an issue here from January 21st to the 27th, 1956. So I'm like, RJ is not a man in his mid 70s. So this is not from, and if you are, please tell me what you've been doing.
My target demo is dead.
Yes. Yeah. Mine too.
It's the best way I can put it.
Yeah.
I'm drawn to this cover because it was the first one that Lawrence Welk appeared on.
Yes. Because that was your other thing. I was like, I know I have all the 50s ones. It might be hard to locate. Is there a backup? And you're like, if there's another one with Lawrence Welk. And I was like, I see here.
Yeah. And there's quite a few with him on it.
He was
there's
massive. One with,
they have a really trippy electric looking cover. And I'm like, oh, this is just... this is beautiful.
Yeah, it's a drawing and it's with the bubbles and all that. Very trippy. Yeah,
this one is standard Welk.
Yeah, just straightforward, got the accordion, big grin on his face. Just like, I'm Lawrence Welk, what are you going to do about it?
And then the title there, Lawrence Welk, TV's newest sensation.
I don't know how old he is here. And I know that like a 1956 30 is like a 2022 70. But he does not look like what I would imagine any newest sensation would look like. He's I'd say 40 something here.
I always blame it on harsh soap in that era.
Lifebuoy.
But he is a guy to me like Ed Sullivan who should not have been on television.
At least he was a musician. Like Ed Sullivan wasn't a performer. He was just some booker.
Right.
It was the weirdest thing.
Like, they don't, neither of them speak well.
No.
He has an accent, which I think he's from North Dakota.
Yes.
But
he sounds
accent,
foreign.
Yeah. I mean, that Schmengi accent, you know, is mocking it. Meanwhile, the guy is from North Dakota. It's the craziest thing. And the fact that he's still on, you know, PBS, that whole group, I'm very obsessed with it. And I always say Lawrence Welk is like a dog whistle to find certain people. Somebody, this is how much I talk about Lawrence Welk. The other day, somebody ordered a cameo saying, this is for my mother. She's not a wrestling fan, but she's related to Lawrence Welk, and she likes to hear people talk about him. So, you know, say whatever you want about Lawrence Welk. So it's this weird, like, oh my God, you know him? Like, it's he's so weird. The whole group, his whole clan is so... like incestuous,
and it has like culty vibes when you watch it. Like it's got a sister like wives kind of Mormon.
Yes. And then the best is when you watch the PBS ones that they air now, that they'll have wraparounds and bumpers of
from the 80s
performers. Yes. of those performers, you know, they've grown up and whatever, and then they'll list like what their kids are doing now, and like no one cares. And it's like, oh, that person married the clarinet player. And you're like, what? It was like everyone, like he just, he ran a cult. Let's say an accordion cult.
It doesn't have religion in it, but it's, there's something culty about it. And for some reason, PBS only pretty much reruns 70s episodes. And I don't know why that is. But yeah, it was, there was a bunch of shows like this in the 50s. There was the Mitch Miller show, like a bunch of band leaders, and not quite a variety show in that it was mostly just, here's our cast, our cult, just doing a bunch of songs, and we might have a guest star maybe, but it was sort of a self-contained variety show. That was like a very, very radio format. And I don't know exactly if Lawrence Welk started in radio with this show, but that would make perfect sense if in fact he did, because it does
really play like one. It has like old standards, and then he would switch it up and do some modern hits.
Well, that was the other thing. Like, they didn't have – this predates, like, American Bandstand or really any of, like, the rock shows where, like, bands would come on and do their songs. So this format was, this house band would do hits of the day, like the top 10 hits of the day, which is – hilarious. Like, there's an infamous Lawrence Welk episode where they do one Toke Over the Line.
Now, the other reason I love that clip of one Toke Over the Line is that it's introduced by Myron Florin, who is Lawrence Welk's, like, right-hand man. And he chokes and coughs during the introduction. Yes. And it's the funny, he gets, it's just a little awkward, perfect little SCTV. This guy's just struggling, you know, got a little phlegm in his throat or whatever. And then to have that moment of awkwardness followed by these two, you know, completely Christian people.
Oh, yeah.
Singing a song because they saw Jesus mentioned in it and thought, hey, this is up our alley. What's a toke? Who cares? Sing the song.
It's probably like a prayer, like a hymn.
Yeah. But making it, and the other thing which needs to be said about them is, like, as much as I love to make fun of them, all the musicians are flawless on the show.
Yeah.
June Castle, she's this ragtime piano woman. Just look her up on YouTube and she's just ripping it up. And you're like, oh my God, good for you. So it's not like, as corny as it is, he clearly comes off like a perfectionist because one seems to be bad.
Everyone is at the top of their game. It's just they can do these completely soulless renditions of songs.
Yes.
And actually, there's still a show like this. Have you ever seen Molly B?
Oh, yeah.
She has this just Midwestern polka band leader. And I am fascinated by those shows because they're still on. I think they're on, like, I don't know, one of those channels. Mm-hmm. But it is the Schmengies. Like, it is, but completely serious. It's her performing in, like, gymnasiums and mm-hmm. old people. It's amazing. And it's like, what are we, 70 years later, and they're still just doing the same exact show?
It's just, it's so inoffensive. It's something very digestible. I always love watching it and go, there's always a guy on it who sings like, nah, and you just, I always go, what happened to that voice? Because it was very clearly a popular kind of singing. And then the whole world at some point went, this voice is stupid. We should stop singing this.
They were like, oh, you know, you don't have to sing like the whitest person ever all the time.
Like, yeah.
I once read a review of John Lydon and Public Image Limited. And the person who wrote it said, John Lydon is the only singer who can make a believable argument to have not been influenced by a single black musician. Just the way that he sings. Yeah. I was like, yeah, checks out. All right. Yeah. Especially
and
in Public Image.
To my understanding, Welk only had occasionally one black man on the show who would just tap dance.
Of course.
Which is not the best optics. Ever.
No. very white, very Midwest. It's presumably aired in Canada.
Mm-hmm. I mean, PBS, so we would get WNED, which is Southern Ontario and Western New York. So whatever Buffalo got, we got.
Okay, so this issue I gave you is from Albany, so it's approaching the area.
And I realize that because there's French in it.
Yes. Which we would get sometimes here in Boston, like the further north you went, like some parts of New Hampshire. If we'd go on vacation to Maine, all of a sudden stuff was in French as well, which was always kind of interesting. Do you speak French?
A little. I can read and get up to, like, I don't know, high school, freshman year was probably stopped, but like very basic.
Do you, we have to ask about Degrassi.
Okay. You know what? So because my cultural head is so old, because I am 77,
yes,
I have a severe blind spot of like late 80s and 90s stuff.
Wow. Okay.
So when people are into Degrassi, I'm watching Dark Shadows.
Okay.
I'm like, you know, just total, there's some stuff where I'm like a caveman in that sense.
Is there any old Canadian stuff like Mr. Dress Up or like King of Kensington or that kind of stuff there, or is even that too new?
So I worked at CBC for a couple years and I had a parody crafting web series there called The Cynical Crafter. And CBC, their headquarters, it's a big building where everything was. And they have the old treehouse from Mr. Dressup. They have a trolley from Mr. Rogers because he worked at CBC once.
Oh, wow.
A bunch of great stuff. And they have old props. And they have a cardboard cutout of Casey or Finnegan, one of the Mr. Dressup puppets.
Yes.
And we wanted to use it for something. So we did a take where we opened a window and the puppet's there just watching. It's very creepy. And then we had to go through legal and like CBC doesn't own it and the family owns it and they don't want anything to do. It was a whole thing. But I also worked with, do you know Fred Penner?
Yeah, Fred Penner's place.
We had him on the show. And that was like the most beautiful moment. He is what he looks like.
Yeah, for people that don't know Fred Penner, his show aired on Nickelodeon in the 80s, but it had been on, I think, CBC for, I don't know, 10 or 15 years before that. It made an enormous amount of, like 1,000 episodes of this show. It was a daily show. It was like 4 hours long, and he would do these original songs, and is very, it's a very sincere show.
Yes, just a sweet, sweet man in that Mr. Rogers vein, but he could sing.
Yeah. He was like an old kind of folky hippie guy, late 60s, who kind of had that Henson-y ideal of like being sincere and not talking down to kids, but also having like this like utopian view of the future kind of guy.
Another cult Canadian show that I remember first reading about in a TV guide was a show called The Hilarious House of Frightenstein.
Yes, with Vincent Price.
With Vincent Price and a guy named Billy Van, who was an incredibly talented comedian, never really left Canada. It was this cult children's horror sketch show. And Vincent Price did wraparounds and poems in the middle. Apparently, he only came in for like 2 days.
Yeah, he did them
like
all
100
at once.
Episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember reading it in the, you know, the whatever happened to section. And it was just this weird show. You see this picture and you go, what is this as a child? And then you look it up. Like, so TV Guide was a gateway.
Totally. I mean, it was in an era we grew up pre-internet when sort of research materials were kind of hard to come by. You couldn't quite watch old stuff. Like it was, unless someone was re-airing it, which people weren't like re-airing Hilarious House of Frightenstein. It was like kind of the only way you could sort of watch things. Mm-hmm. It was like as close as you could get.
It was that. And I would also every summer, my grandmother lives in New York. So every summer when we'd visit her, I would go to the TV museum.
Yes.
And before YouTube, you would have to look up what you wanted to watch on a separate computer, and they would print out these codes, and then you would go into this viewing room and type, and then you started to figure out, I think you were only allowed 2 hours, but if nobody was there, you could stay longer. You started to figure out how the shows were categorized. So Sesame Street would be in the thousands. So you would just pick a random number in the thousands, and then you could get any episode of Sesame Street. Yeah. So I would watch a lot of stuff there that I could just would never have seen anywhere else. But now I go and they're just like, yeah, just go on YouTube.
Yeah, I know. Like that's, I tried to explain the concept that you just described to younger people, and I'm like, it was like a physical YouTube. Like you had to go to YouTube.
Yeah.
They would bring you things.
Print out, they would call out your name, and it was like going into the, but because otherwise you would never be able to see these.
No, and it was kind of amazing they had it at all, because so much of that stuff is lost. Like we dive into the guide in a minute here. I was just looking through, and so many of these shows don't exist anymore. Like
I can't, there's certain game shows I saw and then I'm like, what is this? And I looked it up and just nothing online.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things I always say about Lucille Ball is, you know, I'm not the hugest fan of I Love Lucy, but, that wasn't necessarily the best show of that era or the best sitcom or the best example. But one of the reasons everybody knows it is because she invented reruns because she was pregnant and wanted to keep the show going. And they cinescoped, which was literally filming the video monitor of the show. So the show exists still and it aired. Like that's that simple.
Why
it still continued. Because there are just, they wiped everything. They wiped because tapes were expensive. They just didn't care. So
something that's interesting in here, I did want to point out the lack of ads.
It's very ad-free, especially compared to later TV guides where it's just all cigarettes.
Yeah. I mean, even the back is just an ad for TV Guide.
And a really good ad, by the way. It's this is January, but it looks like Halloween. It's like this super cool mid-century looking owl. And then a bad joke. I never ask who anymore.
And it's so positioned like the Google of television.
Yeah.
You know,
it'll tell you who is on what and when. Because this would be like, I imagine big time then, but when we were growing up, there were so many shows that people would think you were lying. If you were like, I saw this thing, and they'd be like, no, you didn't. And I'd be like, no, it was a real thing. And I'm like, I don't think so. Or you would be like, this guy was on this thing. No. And there was no way to check.
Yeah.
There was no way to check.
There must have been liars who just existed, just made up the weirdest. And they're like, there's no way to verify this. I can say what I want.
Alex Rocco, the actor from Boston who was in the actual mob and actually moved to California to get out of a mob fight. His father knew Leonard Nimoy from the old neighborhood and was like, go out with Leonard. The way he got into acting was by doing just that. He worked as a bouncer at this club, and one other door guy used to get like bit parts and stuff, and they would call the guy at work because people didn't have cell phones. And so Rocco answers the phone and is like, he's not here. I'm an actor. What do you need? And they were like, well, we got this part. And he's like, yeah, I've been in stuff. And they're like, well, what have you been in? And he knew that I think it was Biograph Studios in New York had just burned down. So he named like all these Biograph things that you just couldn't check.
Amazing. Yeah.
And he got his first gig as a goon in Batman 66.
That's it. And that's just why, like, that's what was just so exciting about that era of show business, is that you could just easily lie your way into it.
Yeah. Most people did. I mean, especially the Westerns. I've heard just so many stories that I can count of people being like, and then they were like, can you ride a horse? And I was like, absolutely. And I couldn't, and I broke my legs, but I was an actor. Like, it's just like this complete craziness.
So, speaking of Westerns, may I direct you to page 8?
Yes. Yes.
Where they have Marshall Earp. It's Hugh O'Brien in the Wyatt Earp biography. And there's this beautiful series of photographs at the top of the article, which I call bullshit on, where he's dropping a poker chip and firing his gun before it hits the floor.
Which also would require the camera to be right in the line of fire.
Yes.
It's not happening.
There's no way this is. I don't even think they would have had a camera fast enough to do this.
The other even weirder thing about this two-page spread is, so there's this little thing about Hugh O'Brien. He wrote it about being Wyatt Earp. But on the next page, first of all, there's, I guess it's a drawing of the real Wyatt Earp, who just looks like Edgar Allan Poe. But
which looks nothing like Hugh O'Brien.
Nothing like Hugh O'Brien. But there's an article written by Wyatt Earp's cousin, who's named Welcome, which is the first name apparently, Welcome Ann Earp. And this is so old that this woman is legitimately related to Wyatt Earp.
Yes. Yes. So not only does Hugh O'Brien not look like Wyatt Earp, but in his written article, he writes, and I quote, "It helps too that I happen to be almost exactly Earp's height and weight."
Yes. First of all, I don't think we know that. Second of all, that is in no way, shape, or form a help. I can't think of a single actor who's like, well, the way I won this Oscar was when I got cast, I happened to be the same height and weight as this actor.
Now, what is even crazier is that if you look up Hugh O'Brien's filmography, he plays Wyatt Earp in countless different things.
Yeah. He's in Wyatt Earp.
Alias Jesse James with Bob Hope.
Yes.
As Wyatt Earp. He's in Make Room for Daddy as Wyatt Earp. If you needed a Wyatt Earp, for some reason, he has the market corner.
He was Wyatt. I mean, Westerns were the biggest genre in television then.
Yeah.
And those people were the biggest stars. And for all intents and purposes, they were that historical figure to people. You know, that is Bat Masterson or whoever, even though it was completely nothing at all like any of that stuff.
No.
Which is again why that actual drawing of him is so jarring. And that one just feels like someone at TV Guide was like, they had this Hugh O'Brien thing, they had the pictures, and they were like, what an asshole. Do we know anyone related to Wyatt Earp? Like, put this in here to make him look like a dick.
Just burying Hugh O'Brien. It almost reminds me of, like, you know, Rich Little, sometimes, like, he didn't have the best impressions, but he did them first.
Yeah, I would say about Rich Little, all his impressions were Nixon.
Yes, fair enough. And I just feel like when it comes to Wyatt Earp, Hugh O'Brien got there first.
Hugh O'Brien went, I'm Hugh O'Brien.
And they're like, he's amazing.
He's amazing at this. Yeah, and then there's a weird thing on the next page where they have Shirley McClain, and they call her comedian Shirley McClain, mm-hmm. which I forget about.
Yeah, she was, I guess, branded that way. And she was in Shower of the Stars with two legitimate comedians, Jack Benny and George Burns. And, well, yeah. I will say, even though it says comedian, it says Shirley MacLaine in brackets, and she dances too. So she was already, like, planning an exit strategy.
Yeah, which I guess you would have to do. In theory, Shirley MacLaine's a very beautiful woman. But at this time, I would say she would be considered kind of quirky looking.
Yes.
So I bet that was kind of the only way you could like get in as an actress would be like, but I'm comedic. like that's what Mary Tyler Moore, who's a beautiful woman, but she was like, mm-hmm. she's quirky and comedic. And it was like, okay.
Comedienne meant the producers don't find her attractive.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly. Really... Which is a weird group of people because that includes like Edie Adams right. and Lucille Ball. Yeah,
and it only applied to women because the male comedians were just hideous.
Oh, yeah. And old. Because a lot of them had been like burlesque or vaudeville guys. And they were like the hottest comedians mm-hmm. were like in their 40s.
Yeah.
Which is craziness. Like that was like the hip young guys at that time.
Just George disgusting Burns. Men. George yes. Burns. smoking a cigar. Okay, you want to hear what I've got?
Yeah, let's do Saturday night here. We're on January 21st, 1956.
Saturday, 8 p.m. I've chosen Perry Como.
You only had three choices.
Which is the best, too. Yep. I thought, oh, this is going to be so hard. And then I had basically no choices for anything. Perry Como on his show has Keenan Wynn, who is Edwin's
brother, I think.
Son.
Oh, son.
Son? I think, yes. Keenan Wynn, yes. And now, you correct me if I'm wrong, you play in a band called 30 Seconds Over Tokyo?
Yes, I did. Yes, indeed.
Okay. Was that named after the Van Johnson movie? Or
it
no?
was. It was, yeah.
Okay. So Van Johnson, and he was another person who I believe was of homosexual persuasion, and the studio said, listen, you got to marry somebody.
Yeah,
and
you're a leading
man. And he
ended
up marrying Keenan Wynn's ex-wife.
Yes.
And they were all friends. Yeah. So I wanted to just tie that all together. Ernest Borgnine, and he's credited here as Ernest Marty Borgnine, because that was the big movie he was in.
He was in case
they probably just knew him as Marty.
Can you think of another actor where that's the case of where they would be like, it's Sylvester Rambo Stallone, everybody.
Like, the only people I could think of are people like Pee Wee Herman or Sacha Baron Cohen as Borat, where they would appear in public as it, you know?
Right. But Ernest Borgnine's not like, hey, I'm Marty.
That's like, at no point. And then to round out the variety, they have a billiards champ, which is just great.
And has the best billiards champ name.
Yes. And then... Wait, what is his name? Where is this?
Willie McConey.
Oh my God. Why didn't I write that down?
I'm Willie McConey, billiards champ.
That's a guy who is like a real, must have been a hustler.
Oh yeah, it's got his own cue, big time.
And rounding it out, they have the four lads.
Yeah.
Who sang Istanbul.
Yep. Later covered by They Might Be Giants.
Which is fantastic. And how many people don't realize that's a cover?
Oh, everyone that hears it.
Yeah.
Absolutely everybody.
Yeah.
Except for the cousins of the four lads who are writing articles in magazines about it.
Just so you know.
You didn't write that. Yeah, that's, again, true variety. There's something for everyone there.
Billiards. Yeah, that'll hook a lot of people.
All those McConey heads are going to tune in and fall in love with Marty.
Oh, my God. And then, so I assume that's an hour. I'm just going to assume. So at 9 p.m., true to code, I've picked Lawrence Welk.
Yes.
It's outstanding that they list the songs.
There's a weird thing here, though, and I don't know if this is the person that's listed, but it has to be. They do a song, All at One You Love Her, and it's credited mm-hmm. to Dick Dale.
Oh, Dick Dale... That is weird. I think he worked on the show or in the group of them.
That he's from Quincy, Mass originally. and I believe started as a singer, which is why they gave him that reverb unit, because it was for vocals. Mm. And he started playing. But I wonder if there's footage of Dick Dale on Lawrence Welk. I've never heard of him being on the show before, but
this is something to investigate now. Yeah. But also, as I had mentioned, the guy who chokes during the one toke introduction, Myron Florin.
Yep.
And then the quote to plug the article later from Lawrence Welk, which says everything. Mom may like lemonade and buttermilk, but at heart, she's a champagne girl. So just really cornered the market on the moms.
But also it's kind of like, yeah, do your mom. Like, it's a little bit like, at heart,
yeah,
she's a champagne girl. I know the real your mom. Like, it's, yeah, Lawrence Welk pulling a little your mom on there.
Yeah, so they would, you know, put on the Welk show and let loose.
There's also a sitcom I'd never heard of before, but it has the most made up 50s sounding sitcom name, and it's called It's Always Jan.
She was up to that. Was the answer.
Jan and her roommates hire a new housekeeper and nearly start a revolution in their apartment building as a result. Janice gave up, quote, the pajama game for the TV game. Story in next week's TV Guide.
I also love how planned out it is.
Yeah, we know next week. They already wrote the article. Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Have you ever been to a TV taping, like a non-wrestling TV taping?
Yes. As a child, I went to, it was very Canadian, the Royal Canadian Air Force. That was the name of the show. And it was like, I don't know how to explain it. I mean, it was a sketch show, but they would do a lot of like light political comedy.
Air Farce, Canadian. You said, not Air Force.
No. Okay. No, Air Farce. Yeah.
I'll have to look that up. I'm unfamiliar with the Royal Canadian Air Force.
They're very, very big only in Canada.
Okay. There's a lot of things like that. Well, there's, yes, was it This Hour Has 22 Minutes or something like that? What's that?
Yes. There's a current show. That would be like the lead in.
Yeah. Okay. I have heard of that, but now I'll look up Air Force.
Okay. So Sunday, this is a big one for me. I picked at 8 p.m. I picked Comedy Hour. I believe, how do you say this? Leo DeRoche? Should we give Leo him the DeRoche? French pronunciation?
I think it's DeRoche.
Okay, we'll say Leo. Okay. And he has Wally Cox, yes, rumored lover of Marlon Brando, who was also, Wally Cox was like, and correct me if I'm wrong, like the first nerd.
Yes. His whole thing was he was a nerd. He was like, who was the, there's a Hanna-Barbera character that's kind of like Wally Cox.
Didn't he voice a character?
I think so. I can't remember who it was now.
Underdog.
Yes, that's, yeah, what I'm thinking of. The underdog, when underdog is his shoeshine boy alter ego, they basically just draw him as if Wally Cox, right, was a dog. He did a lot of the voices on that show, I think.
Yeah, he was very, but he played that character. He's not, yes, that guy in real life. He was in the military and,
yeah,
they said he was very athletic. So true to wrestling, you know, very much Wally Cox has a gimmick.
Yeah, his gimmick was nerd.
Yeah.
What was the WWF, was it IRS, the guy, Irwin?
Yes, Irwin R. Scheister.
Yes, yeah, that was his gimmick. He was an accountant, but he was like nerdy wrestler. Yeah.
And he would wrestle in a suit, or he would have like a shirt and tie, and it would just be covered in sweat.
Pocket protector and a briefcase.
Yes. Real classy stuff. Also on the show, Ernie Kovacs. I mean, I was just watching, there's a collection of his like short visual blackouts online, and I'm like, this is TikTok.
Yeah.
It's mind-blowing. And he's a person who I'm like, I don't know how he steered his career, but I'm like, why aren't people talking about him more?
A lot of his stuff was lost. Like, for years, it didn't re-air. And then he also died young, which yes, didn't help. Edie Adams really doesn't get enough credit for being not just a muse, but like a co-partner in a lot of the stuff he came up with. Her autobiography is fantastic. It's really great. There's in the middle, one of my favorite things is, you know, most autobiographies, like in the middle, there'll be that section with like photos. Yes. And there's a section, there's a picture of her and JFK, and the caption just says, "I didn't, but not because I wasn't asked." And it's hilarious. And she's just great. And there's a really actually very good made for TV movie about Ernie Kovacs, where Ernie Kovacs is played by Jeff Goldblum.
Yes.
That came out in 81 or 82. But yeah, he was one of the guys, and I was actually going to say this about wrestling earlier, where they figured out the language of television early and did stuff you could only do on television. Ernie Kovacs did that. The wrestling thing of looking into the camera and, and sort of, you know, caught like addressing the audience as if they're your, you know, the rival, like no one that hadn't been done before. Cause you didn't have that technology, like that format. So those made sense that those were sort of the early pioneers.
Yes. And to round out that roster are the Gentle Maniacs. Are you familiar with them at all?
I do not know anything about the Gentle Maniacs.
Okay, so are you familiar with the Three Stooges were originally hired by Ted Healy?
Yes.
To be Ted Healy and the Three Stooges, and he would whack them on the head and blah, 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 blah. Three Stooges caught on, so Mo and Larry and Chimp and were like, let's do our own thing. To hell with Ted Healy. Like, he seems mean and limiting. So he left. So they left the Three Stooges. They became the Three Stooges on their own, and they were replaced by the Gentle Maniacs.
Oh, God.
And needless to say, the Gentle Maniacs did, I mean, they did enough that they were working. But then, after a certain point, Ted Healy hires the Stooges back to work with him. And the Gentle Maniacs tried to sue the Three Stooges, saying that they stole the Three Stooges' name, which they totally did not. And the Three Stooges easily proved it. And then the Gentle Maniacs, like, this is on their way out. Like, I don't think they exist after 1956. So this is just the bottom of the barrel.
I'm wondering if there's have you seen footage of them doing their shtick?
No, I've seen pictures of it, and I've also seen like a quote where they were like, we're different than the Three Stooges because they would do their physical comedy with their hands, like eye poking and slaps, and we would use instruments.
It's like
we would use fiddles, and I was like, okay.
It's like when Vanilla Ice tried to say that Ice Ice Baby was different from Under Pressure, and he goes, no, theirs goes din 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 din, and ours goes din 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 din. That's literally a quote from him.
Yes. So this is, the Gentle Maniacs are really the Vanilla Ice
of physical
Ted
comedy
Healy universe. Yes.
And I've heard them referenced as that more times than I can count.
But great, great name.
Oh, yeah. I'm surprised that wasn't the name of a punk band in like the late 70s. That's such like a New York City, like cramp style band.
Have it in my back pocket when someone needs the name of like a tag team or something.
Yep. It's Gentle Maniacs.
And the name Lukewarm. I always loved it. I'm like, this really, somebody should wrestle as Lukewarm.
I was watching the band, the Dead Milkmen, have a great YouTube show called Big Questions with the Dead Milkmen every Saturday. It's just the four of them. They have a question, but they were coming up with band names the other day. And one of them was like, oh, there's a band name that I always wanted to use and I'm keeping in my back pocket. And it's the Dick Moves.
unassuming band is just gonna have that name forced upon them.
Yeah, it could work for anything there. Now I'm thinking the Gentle Maniacs as wrestlers, like part of their gimmick would be like they'd put their coat down on the ring before they like later on, you know, like
yes. And a little bit of those Looney Tunes gopher after you, no after you.
Yes.
Like a little bit of that, and then just the most violent, vicious wrestlers.
Yes. I love it. I'm buying a t-shirt. So you're watching that at 8, and then what are you doing?
Yeah. 9 p.m. the Alcoa hour, which is and this TV at this point, you could kind of see a lot of plays. Like there were playwrights, you know, that would bleed in. So this struck me because it's called A Patch of Faith. It stars Lee J. Cobb as an Italian professor who holds a benefit concert for his destitute students. However, which blew my mind, it's directed by Sidney Lumet.
Sidney Lumet, who was a New York theater director before, really.
Yes, and then, of course, Dog Day Afternoon, Serpico, Network, 12 Angry Men.
It is very strange how much, I mean, if you look at Rod Serling, he was a playwright. And in the first few things he did on TV were filmed plays. And PBS even had like, they would weekly have like a play, a filmed play on through the 80s. Like they did a lot of like weird New York experimental theater. I remember I was looking at an issue a couple weeks ago from 82. I think it was 82. And they, no, it was in the 70s, and they had a 76, actually, they had a play with Brad Dourif in it. That was like a filmed play that, cause he was doing like weird off Broadway experimental theater. So
yes,
it was a staple for like decades. And then just people were like, we don't want to see plays on TV.
Yes. No. You just go, well, there's no way this could be bad. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, at least for one viewing. The worst it could be is boring.
Yes. But you would go, oh, that was well-directed, at least.
Yeah. It was slow, but well-directed.
Yes. So that is my choice there.
How about Monday?
Monday, 8 p.m., we're starting hot with Mayor of the Town. And the reason I picked that is because I am a Jerry Lewis buff. And I'm obsessed with him. I often stole a lot of his personality for wrestling because he's such a horrible person.
Oh, it was the worst. Yeah.
Yeah. And the way, I mean, he would be on Dick Cavett and they played a clip of, you know, that wonderful boardroom pantomime he does?
Oh, yes.
They play that clip and they come back. Everyone's applauding. And he goes, I don't know if you could tell, but the audio in the studio was off just by a hair. And I'm like, you are a horrible person.
Oh, yeah. And he thought he was the Nutty Professor where he becomes the cool guy character at one point? That's how he thought he was.
And he certainly became that character.
Yeah.
You know, in that, especially when he, you know, away from Dean and all that stuff, he was compensating for whatever.
Just a smarmy. And we were talking about SCTV off mic before, and Martin Short has my favorite Jerry Lewis impression because he does that later, older, gum-chewing, serious, bitter Jerry Lewis. Nobody did that. People would do the lady, but nobody did like pre-King of Comedy asshole Jerry Lewis, and Martin Short did.
And it's that, because I would always be a bad guy when I wrestled, and I saw that, and I just went, this is it. This is a man who's so confident in himself and incredibly successful, incredibly talented, like an amazing director.
Invented video assist.
Yes. And then just gets so far removed from reality.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And then all of a sudden he's doing slapstick of another kind and you're going, what the hell
what
is
are you
this?
Doing? Oh, God, that movie.
So he often, it was said that he hated women and he often was the person who said it.
Yeah. Oh, and women aren't funny. Like he's the women aren't funny guy. Like that's his thing.
Yes. However, one woman he always used stars in Mayor of the Town. Her name is Kathleen Freeman. She is fantastic. And she's also in Ready to Rumble.
Oh, okay.
With David Arquette's father, Louis Arquette.
Yes.
And they're playing Oliver Platt's parents. Kathleen Freeman is in every Jerry Lewis movie. She's also the nun in Blues Brothers.
Okay. Okay.
You would know one of those, like if you saw her face, I've seen her. Like, I know who this is. So I always enjoy seeing her.
Have you ever seen Mayor of the Town?
No, unfortunately, no, but I did look it up. Natalie Wood is sometimes in it, which is a bizarre. And that DeForest Kelly is in 3 episodes.
Oh, and I bet he's angry. I don't think he ever played a role where he wasn't angry.
Young and angry. Just and yelling. She's a maid or a housekeeper for the mayor, and they get up to stuff.
Yeah,
and
this is like the Merrily. This is the most cliche episode, this title. It's great.
Yep. And the premise is she takes care of a 6-month-old baby.
Marilyn minds the baby.
Yeah. That's...
Yeah.
That's it.
That's a classic. That's right up there with being stuck in an elevator. One thing I love about Jerry Lewis, before I move on from him, is the telethons were like, you could get a doctorate in psychology by watching like 2 or 3 of the telethons nonstop and just writing a paper about his slow descent into madness over the 3 days. Because at least when I was growing up and I didn't sleep much, the greatest thing that weekend was if you tuned into that thing at like, you know, 4 in the morning and he's like, you know, shirts unbuttoned and he's just smoking and like going on weird rants. And it was just great.
There is a wonderful Inside Edition back when Maury hosted it. So when Maury had credibility, this is how far back we're going. And it follows Jerry doing a telethon behind the scenes. And it's, he's complaining about not having enough Eskimo pies in the fridge. And it's so beautiful. He's in a tuxedo and a robe. And at some point, he you know, he's got the oxygen. It's so ridiculous. And at some point, he's waiting in a green room. And this woman says, Jerry, can you take a picture with my kids? And he points at his watch and he goes, honey, not now. Now is not the time. And, you know, to say no is one thing. But then to flip the tables and make it clear to her that she picked the wrong time.
How dare you?
Oh, yeah. My God. And then meanwhile, he'll go out with the kid in the wheelchair and then sing You'll Never Walk Alone.
Kick her down the stairs. Yeah.
Oh, my God. Shades of Rick Rude.
Yes. He's the original Rick Rude. Yeah. I always wonder if people have seen The King of Comedy, which is not a comedy. It's basically a sequel to Taxi Driver. People haven't seen that Scorsese movie. That Jerry Lewis is Jerry Lewis. And I always wondered if he knew he was playing basically himself there, or if he thought it was like a stretch and he's such a great actor. Cause I feel like he wasn't that self-aware.
No, but, and then yet that's like the one movie where he's just like, wow, this is incredible. This
he's
is
great.
Like a different side of Jerry where you're like, and that was also, I heard offered to Johnny Carson, but I also Sammy Davis Jr.
Yeah. Who I don't think would, I think it's perfect as Jerry Lewis. Cause that is like, because I'm not a huge Carson fan, and he always struck me as kind of an asshole. Like he seemed like the person Ed McMahon had the reputation as, and Ed McMahon was like kind of a good guy,
right?
But he couldn't play that. Like it wasn't, not that Jerry Lewis was a likable asshole, but there's something watchable about it. Like it's fascinating.
Yeah.
In a way that's not like the other guys. I was completely unaware of her. I'm going to try to, I'm curious about Mayor of the Town.
She's great. She's fantastic. And she's in any Jerry Lewis movie. You'll just spot her. Once you see her face, you'll always see her face. So that takes us to 8:30. And I picked a game show that I couldn't really find any information on called You Can Quote Me. Newsmaking guest of honor is quizzed by press panel. And J.A. Sullivan, the WCAX news director, is moderator. And this is back when like game shows were a sign of intelligence.
Yeah. This was the New York intelligentsia. Panel. Yeah.
Yes. They would always have like a publisher on, you know, that was like the big, and like, it just sounds really, really boring.
This seems local. I feel like this might be local Albany news thing. Yeah. But this is when like To Tell the Truth, What's My Line? Those shows were just huge. And it really would be. It would like, he's the editor of Esquire magazine, and he'd be like, have a pipe. And it was like, it was very, very, very heady kind of stuff, but in a goofy way. I have not seen this one, but that sounds pretty amazing. Although you did pass up science fiction theater, which this episode is called Sound of Murder. And the plot is a scientist pits scientific fact against a false murder charge.
Now, the reason I passed it up is because at 9, I wanted to watch I Love Lucy.
Okay.
Because I thought, you know, I figured the game show would be a half hour. If I picked the science fiction theater, it would probably be an hour. So I really got strategic with this. And the Lucy one, they go on a romantic voyage to Europe and wants Ricky to join her on a second honeymoon. But her plans go awry when Ricky spends most of his time with the ship's band.
That's a crazy episode that completely just veers from the normal plots on I Love Lucy.
Yeah. Just to be that far removed from everything. Oh, the band. He always finds
playing with the band.
It's one of those shows that I guess is just been so normalized that we forget how weird it is to have Fred and Ethel just travel with them always.
Yeah. Who are clearly like 20 years older than them. Probably
older. And also, you know, they're landlords.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like,
but yet Ricky always seemed to have more money. It was very, I don't think they worked out the math.
No, Ricky always seemed like he was really loaded.
Yeah.
Like he just carried himself like that. He always looked nice suits and everything, but they had a really shitty apartment.
And what they don't, I think also what kind of gets erased because, you know, it's Lucy and it's like, oh, she did the thing with the chocolate and the thing making squishing the grapes, is how much Desi is in there with his music.
Oh,
you have like full musical numbers.
Yeah, it was the Desi and Lucy show. Like, yeah. Lucy kind of overshadowed him because she did so much stuff later and on her own. But it really was like a co-equal show when that show started. Like, people forget he was very famous. He was a very famous band leader. And it was like a novelty to, especially then, where he didn't necessarily have a show anchored by a woman like that. It almost was sort of a Trojan horse, and that it's like, it's the Desi Arnaz show with Lucy, right, and then it kind of, you know, becomes something else. There are few human beings on earth I found more terrifying as a child than 80s era Lucy. Stone Pillow Lucy horrified me.
Oh my God. Yes, absolutely. And then who was also very alarming, and the first time I saw him was, I think he hosted one of the early episodes of Saturday Night Live, Desi in Color.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, oh my God. Oh, what did you do to your teeth, man?
Yeah. Same with Rod Serling. Like when he did Night Gallery, you're like, you do smoke a lot. Jesus, man.
That skin, they look like catcher's mitts.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
my God.
And they're younger, I guess, you know. Right. But yeah, black and white is very forgiving when you're smoking 2 or 3 packs of cigarettes a day for years. Oh, so, I can't believe people did it.
The reason I plotted all that out is because at 9:30, I wanted to watch wrestling.
Okay.
And it just says Wrestling Chicago. So, right. And they have different localized, like before there's a Wrestling Toronto. And it reminds me of what a novelty wrestling is.
Yeah.
Where you don't even need to know, like baseball games, they say at least who's playing. It says boxing here. It at least says preliminaries. Like something is happening. Wrestling is just, I mean, they knew then in 1956, there's a New York Times article. The New York Times didn't even cover wrestling because they knew then it was fixed, which is the best because so many old wrestlers pretend that it was real and everybody thought it was real. And it's like, guys, the New York Times in 1956 was pretty adamant. So, like, a lot of times the joke is only on the wrestler then.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is fascinating to me. But, like, yeah, it's just like saying, let's go to the circus.
Yeah.
You know?
We know what we're getting by that one word alone. Like, if it's a thing you like, that you're going to like it.
Yes. It's going to be something. And that's it. And it's just, that is the novelty of it.
Growing up here, I don't speak Spanish, but we had a Univision channel and they would show Lucha Libre, and I don't speak Spanish, but I watched that every Saturday. I loved it. And it's like, I didn't know the names of the people, like, but it was kind of the same thing. You're like, oh, I know what I'm getting. This is cool to watch. And it's entertaining. Like, it's like a very simple sort of primal entertainment.
Yes. Yeah, you don't, I mean, talk about, well, I often say that the fans are like the lowest common denominator because you don't really need to know anything to watch it.
No.
You get it.
Yeah. There's not like subtleties. You're like, this match is actually a commentary on feudalism in ancient Japan. No.
I wish. I've tried. It doesn't read.
Although you could argue a lot of that crazy Japanese stuff is a commentary on what happens when your country gets annihilated with an atomic weapon in the mid-century.
Oh, yes.
Some real
absolutely
odd things Japanese, that come out of that.
Japanese wrestling is fascinating because they really, and ahead of us, they had a legitimate style where it was like an MMA hybrid. But then at the same time, they would also have the most ridiculous stuff.
Oh,
and
yeah.
They would often have the same people doing both.
Yeah.
And in America, you were either a serious real wrestler or you were like a comedy wrestler. Right. Now the derogatory term is meme wrestler. Like you do a stupid thing just so somebody makes a gif of it, you know?
So like Leapin' Lenny would be a meme wrestler.
Oh yes. Throwing frisbees.
Frisbees with poems on them.
Yes. What a strange human being.
Yeah. Wasn't he Macho Man's brother?
Yes.
Or still is.
Still is. And very weird, very smart, very well-spoken, but just bizarre.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, there's a lot of comics like that. There's a lot of, like, 80s comics that I'll be like, that guy's really smart. What a fucking weirdo. Like, I don't understand this guy's brain. Yeah. Or just like, it makes perfect sense to me. There is a thing on at 9:30 that I did want to mention that is opposite the wrestling, but it's bizarre. And it's a show called Mr. and Mrs. North. I've never heard of before. It says this episode's called Forgotten Grave. And then the plot sounds like a sitcom. It goes, Pam and Jerry do some babysitting for a dog and discover a grave in a deserted house. Like these, it's like Mad Libs. Like none of those things.
It's a film, but also they don't disclose what the genre is.
No, and it's also only a half hour.
Yeah, that's very weird.
Very strange. Very weird. Although I will mention too, boxing would do a similar. This one happens to say who's fighting, but boxing would also just kind of say boxing.
Yes.
Later, they would have be like, it's Monday Night Fight, or like you would brand the show when it would become more national. But yeah, same thing. It was just kind of like boxing.
Yes.
Golf.
So Tuesday, 8 p.m., I have picked Phil Silvers.
My favorite.
The Phil Silvers Show also seemed to be the ultimate point of influence for comedians I liked growing up. Like Steve Martin and Larry David always brings up as like, that was the show. And I mean, of course, Steve Martin did that horrible remake with Dan Aykroyd and Phil Hartman, and they tried.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, this is the a fantastic show.
He's such a weird character because he looked like the nerd Wally Cox would portray, but on camera, and this was pretty much like what he was like from what I've read and people who I've talked to who knew him, was he was kind of a tough ass, like schemer. Like he kind of didn't mess with them. He was like hung around with mobsters, huge gambling problem, really quick and funny though. Like, and that's the character he plays. Like a schemer for people. If for some reason you don't know Phil Silvers, Top Cat is Phil Silvers. Like the show Top Cat, all those characters are based around the Phil Silvers show. And just some of my favorite comedy sitcoms ever were Phil Silvers episodes, and so modern, like the way that the misunderstandings would like build on each other and things would get just insane, very much like Seinfeld.
And also I think notable as being kind of an unlikable lead.
Yeah He's not a good guy.
No and that does remind me of, you know, Curb Your Enthusiasm, how you sustain that unlikable person but as the center of the show.
Yeah, charming as hell, and you kind of want to see him get away with stuff, but you're like, he's kind of a shit. Like, he's kind of, he's just really self-involved, very selfish, always trying to play an angle to benefit himself. Like, he's not selfless in any way, which is hilarious.
My Phil Silvers Show trivia is that an extra in the Phil Silvers Show is the first credit ever of a young Dick Cavett.
Oh, I did not know that. I'm sure Dick Cavett talks about that all the time.
I talked to Dick Cavett about it.
Did you really? In what context did you meet Dick Cavett?
Well, for my birthday 2 years ago, David Arquette pulled the stops and got me a phone call with Dick Cavett.
That's amazing.
Yeah. He was just so sweet. And oh my God, like just a life changing. I was just asking about, you know, I mean, he knew Stan Laurel. I'm like, who should I? There's one of those things where you're like, I'm just going to talk to this person all day. But like, who's at the top of my list of like, who does he know that nobody knows anymore?
Right.
And Stan Laurel and I think Ethel Mirman. And then he wrote on Jerry Lewis's failure of a talk show.
Yeah.
So I had to ask about that.
And he was like famously friends with Groucho Marx. And like Dick Cavett, for anyone who likes podcasts, like interview podcasts, they would not exist without Dick Cavett. A ton of those are up on YouTube now. Like his 70s shows, there's like a four-parter of him with Orson Welles. There's one with him with Bette Davis, the Robert Mitchum one. Like just these really great, in-depth.
Katharine Hepburn one is great.
That one's great. Just weird interviews that are just Richard Burton, like just stories people never told on other things. Actors getting to really be themselves and, especially the 70s ones, because he's interviewing a lot of actors who have reached the age where they just don't give a fuck. And so they're like, I'll tell you everything. And he really captures that. It's nuts. That's so cool. That might be the best birthday gift I've ever heard of anyone receiving.
Easily. No one can. I'm just like, we're done. We're good. Yep. Just wrap it up.
How long did you talk to him for?
Like 30, 40 minutes.
Wow.
Decent. And I came prepared with, because I didn't want to waste any time.
Of course, yeah.
And David's grandfather is Charlie Weaver.
Yep. Who's on the cover of TV Guide.
Yes. I sent it to him, by the way.
Oh, nice.
I took a screenshot and sent it to him. And it's like, oh, so nice. He was on Dick Cavett with Don Knotts and the Lennon Sisters.
Yeah. Of course. What
that's
a lineup.
That's a panel. Yeah.
Don Knotts and anyone really on a panel. We don't have 2022 needs a Don Knotts, and we don't have a modern Don Knotts, and it's a shame.
We don't. I'm trying my best.
That's the problem with kids today. They don't have a Don Knotts.
There's no nervous man.
Actually, one of my favorite comedies of all time. Have you ever seen The Love God?
The best. It's him because he's a little more adult.
Yes, and it's written by Nat Hinken, who created The Phil Silver Show and wrote The Phil Silver Show in Car 54. Yes. It's very much that humor. It's great.
And also looks beautiful. Like, it has a distinct palette. It's really nice.
And Francis, it's great.
Phil Silvers, but honorable mention to Martha Ray, who's on at the same time, only because one of her guests is Paul Lynde.
Yes. Yes, this is pre Bye Bye Birdie, Paul Lynde. When was Bye Bye Birdie? 62?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I mean, he's the last one listed.
What is he known for at 56? I guess he'd be doing stand-up or something?
Maybe. I'm curious. He might have been showing up on these shows just as a sketch player, basically.
He is Paul Lynde. You put him in anything, and it's watchable.
So 8:30, I threw a real curveball here, and I decided to watch Oral Roberts. Televangelist Oral Roberts.
Yeah.
Because, and you realize, like, oh, why is that older generation all, like, weird and stuff? It's like, because they had these guys on in prime time saying whatever they wanted. So next to, you know, the same way you would love Milton Berle or Martha Ray or whatever, you have Oral Roberts, and you're taking them serious.
Doing, like, 1800s fire and brimstone, like, carnival Barker-style religion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At 8:30
on a network.
Tuesday. Yeah. Yeah. That's just incredible to me, and says a lot about, you know, America.
Oh, yeah.
And even now, because you're like, I feel like we're still suffering from the fallout
of
putting Oral Roberts on primetime.
Still have the 700 Club and all those other things. Also, the only person I think I've ever heard of named Oral.
Yes, probably. Oral and Welcome are the two new names we figured out today.
Those just sound like someone's like, I don't know what to name my kid. Get me a dictionary. I don't know. Flip to a page. Welcome. Fine. Like, they don't sound like names.
Whatever. It's like, that's when they must have had like 8 brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
They
we've run out of names. How many names are in the Bible? We used all of them. How about Oral? Fine.
9 p.m. I picked Danny Thomas because I've not heard a nice thing about him.
No.
I've also, unlike Jerry Lewis, have seen nothing redeeming on screen either.
No,
seem talented. He does not seem attractive or genuine or any. I can't think of one reason he should be on television.
But was a massive star, like one of the biggest stars on television for like a decade. And yeah, it's completely, I don't know why. Marlo Thomas, sure. That girl, she's very likable, beautiful girl, very funny. Danny Thomas? I don't get it.
Just nothing at all. And so the 9:30, I went with Red Skelton.
Yes.
Because I feel like I should give him another shot. Because I always knew of him from the Christmas special.
Yeah.
Where he's the hobo clown and he's looking in the window. And it's so sad.
Yeah.
You know, and it's so emotional that as a kid, you know what I mean? You want to see something a little more
exciting. Him in his prime. Yeah.
Yeah. So I want to give him another shot. Red special guest will be Melville Cooper and Reginald Denny as Freddy the Freeloader. Here we go again.
Yep.
Red stows away on a luxury liner.
Oh, that's got to be bad.
That's not, but in a way that I will watch it.
Yeah. Yeah. Fair enough.
But I also heard he was a guy who was more hilarious, like off camera, and he would work blue when they were not filming.
Yeah, I get he was a club comic and didn't quite translate to TV. Science Fiction Theater is also on this night as well. And I only want to mention it because this episode is called Frozen Sound. So there's two sound episodes. This is foreign agents mysteriously get top security secrets from a meeting that was held in a soundproof room. They've made this sound so boring.
This is terrible. And yet that was science fiction of the day.
Yeah, how do you hear stuff in a soundproof room? Wow, that's crazy.
Wednesday, 8 p.m., I went with Arthur Godfrey. Similar to Danny Thomas, similar to Ed Sullivan, sounded like a horrible person. I've heard he was anti-Semitic. I've also heard that disputed. I heard he owned a hotel, and they had a no Jewish people allowed in the hotel policy, and they changed it when he took it over because they knew people would say anti-Semitic things about him.
That doesn't sound like he wasn't. That sounds like he wanted to make more money.
Yes. He does not sound like a nice person at all. Yeah, I mean, like Ed Sullivan, so in control of new talent. He sounded like a powerful person. Yeah.
Yeah. The power those guys wielded. Insane.
The only reason. And then at 9 p.m., I picked Kraft Theater. Home is the Hero. It's a drama. It's on Broadway, but notably has Anthony Perkins in it.
Yes, this is pre-Psycho, 10 years before Psycho, Anthony Perkins, not 10 years, 5 years, who again was this like amazingly heralded young theater actor. Who I think people haven't seen in anything but Psycho or the sequels. And when he pops up in stuff, he's kind of great in everything, especially at this era. He has such a weird energy.
Yes.
He's like Crispin Glover or something.
Yes, there is. And there is and I'm speaking in traditional terms, there is that, I guess, feminine quality, that non-masculine when there's really strong males on the screen.
Yeah.
And you can obviously see it in Psycho. It's very interesting. And then you've seen the sequels that he directed.
Yeah, Psycho 3 is amazing.
Yes. He seemed to care about it, though.
Yeah, he was like, I want to do, if we're going to do this, both Psycho 2 and 3 are very good and are kind of about dealing with trauma and also very much like about redemption in a weird way. He's... They made those movies because slasher movies got huge. So, which is so weird. Like 20 years later, Friday the 13th comes in, Halloween comes out, and they're like, let's do Psycho 2. It ends up being this movie about a sad guy who just wants to make the world better and is sorry for what he did, and people keep fucking with him.
Yes. Because they are like, it was like, because they already beat the slasher to the punch. So they don't want to do it again.
Yeah.
So they're already ahead of the race.
Did you ever see the pilot for the terrible Bates Motel show from the 80s?
No.
Oh, it's bad. It's real bad.
Oh, my God.
Playing Norman Bates was, oh, my God, from Harold and Maude.
Bud Cort.
Bud Cort playing.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. It is called Bates Motel. I think it's from like 87 or 88. It's real bad. But worth watching if you're a fan because it is strange.
Yes. I will look this up too.
It's very strange.
Thursday, 8 p.m., I wanted to contrast Oral Roberts with Bishop Sheen. Bishop Sheen is a guy who is often, Milton Berle would joke about, like they would often use him as a punchline if they needed someone religious or clean. They would just say, oh, yeah, and they went over and they said, who was there? Bishop Sheen. And there'd be 8 minutes of laughter. And it was always a joke I never got, obviously. He seems to be, you know, being a bishop and the Catholic Church seems to be the opposite Oral Roberts, full of shit in a different way.
This was a talk show he had. So this was, he had guests on, they like discussed things. Oral Roberts was literally like, I'm in an arena telling you're going to go to hell, send me money.
Yes, he was a little more subtle in how he was pushing it.
There was a show called Mark Saber on at the same time, and just this episode's called Date with Murder.
These are fantastic titles. And
they
also
really are.
I love that they, you know, titled the episodes too. That also makes me incredibly happy. Let me see. 8:30. Who did I pick? Oh, there is a show called Climax.
Yes.
With an exclamation mark. However, I chose Dragnet.
I love Dragnet.
It's great. It's great. And, you know, the radio show is great. This is great. Sergeant Friday seeks a man accused of robbing two stores using only a sealed envelope with instructions to hand over the money or else. Oh, I just realized they also have it listed in brackets next to it. They have film.
Yeah, so it's not on video. Yeah, I think that's what they mean.
Yeah. So who cares? Why are they telling people this?
There must have been
That's
people.
That's fascinating.
That must have been like if something was in black and white where growing up people would be pissed if you didn't tell them. They'd be like, wait a minute. This is on film? This isn't cool video? Yeah. What the hell? Jack Webb is such a weird character. Wrote, produced the show, was a notorious drunk. Someone I know worked on, I think, the second Dragnet series in the 60s said that they would film all the stuff where he had to move around before lunch because they knew after lunch he was immobile. And what they would do often is they would tilt the camera on its side and lay down a filing cabinet and have him leaning on it. But he's laying down doing his lines. And when you watch some of those episodes, you can tell like he's basically passed out. Yeah. He's like passed out doing my friend Dana Gould has there was an estate sale at Jack Webb's house and he has Jack Webb's like liquor set, like his decanters and stuff. I love LA. Like it's having not grown up there and it's so exotic and it's on everything I ever watched growing up. Like Dragnet is such a great time capsule of LA over like a 20-year period. And it's just really cool to watch even for that alone.
And then at 9 p.m., I picked People's Choice, which there is an ad for at the bottom of the page.
Yeah.
Sponsored by Borden's. I'm not sure what Borden's is.
I think it was sweetened condensed milk, I think.
Okay, fair enough. That seems in line with this because it stars Jackie Cooper, Pat Breslin, and Cleo, the Talking Hound.
Everyone knows Cleo the Talking Hound.
Who could forget? And Cleo looks nonplussed in the ad. I've seen happier hounds.
This hound is like, again with this shit? You should just let me die.
And this episode, Sock goes out bird hunting with a pretty girl and winds up in the doghouse with both Mayor Peoples and his daughter Mandy. It seems the girl is a photographer, and neither the mayor nor Mandy approves of the pictures she takes.
So Sock is not the dog. I don't know where the dog even comes in here. You have a talking dog. No. It's not even in the plot.
Yes. I think Cleo is Cleo. I think Sock is Jackie Cooper.
Okay.
Is what I think.
So presumably this girl takes like bikini shots or like Betty Page style pinups or something of herself.
Yeah. No, this is uncouth.
And we're in the doghouse.
Bishop Sheen.
We have a talking dog. We have to be classier.
Yes. Let's clean up your act. Cleo is watching. And then at 9:30 p.m., there is a show and it sounded so fantastic that I looked it up and I watched this episode yesterday.
Oh, nice.
Colonel March stars Boris Karloff as, I guess, a Sherlock Holmes kind of thing. The episode is Abominable Snowman. Members of the Himalayan Mountaineering Club are being threatened by a man disguised as a weird creature. So I look anything, you know, Boris Karloff, similar to Fred Gwynn, is a man who is more than the monster.
Oh, absolutely.
So anytime you can see them not in that makeup, you can see them like aggressively acting their asses off. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Like enjoying being a human and not having to do any of that stuff. And he's also great. I mean, you don't look at him and go in this and go, that's Boris Karloff and whatever. Like Bela Lugosi is, you know, kind of screwed either way.
Yeah. Bela Lugosi was not a versatile actor, whereas Boris Karloff did comedy so well, which most people, I mean, the Grinch alone for people who would ever question, but like even stuff like The Raven, but the 50s era of Boris Karloff is a really strange era because this is kind of before the shock theater Monster Kid revival. And also before that sort of 70s when he was in a bunch of weird stuff like Frankenstein 80 and he hadn't quite rode the line of like the Mad Monster Party or that kind of stuff yet either. Right. So he's
into that Vincent Price territory. Yet.
Yeah. It's kind of this lost era. So was this worth watching?
Well, it's interesting to see. It's great to see him, you know, doing serious stuff. Can I spoil the episode?
Spoil it. Yeah. People? Yeah. Go for it. This thing from 1956.
So they're showing a reel from their mountaineering expedition in this room. You know, oh, look, we saw this view of this peak or whatever the hell it is. And then you see an abominable snowman. The shadow appears in the room. And he kills someone in the room. And it's like, so it's then like they have to figure out who it is. And I thought it was going to be very supernatural, but it was clear that it was going to, it was a human. And they were like, who dressed up as the Abominable Snowman? I was like, ah, I thought they were going to, and he only appears then and then appear. And then it's like a real, like a whodunit, because it must've been in this room.
Yeah.
And then there's a chase on a roof and they finally grab him and unmask him. And of course it's not the guy they thought it was. It was always the guy standing next to him.
It's very Scooby-Doo. It's very Scooby-Doo. Yes.
Very Scooby-Doo. It's Scooby-Doo. It's a classic Abominable Snowman costume, too.
Oh, that's amazing. So, yeah, because this was, they started moving away from apes always being the murderer.
Yeah.
It was always the 40s, always apes.
Yes. This is just a spray-painted ape costume, yeah. Really.
Like, what are we going to do with these apes? Have you ever heard the... Have you ever heard the story of the Howling 2?
I think I did a trailer reaction to it.
So that's my, your sister's a werewolf, but there's a hilarious thing in that where, so they shot that in Eastern Europe and Christopher Lee is in it.
Yes.
And they rented the costumes from Universal and Universal shipped them monkey costumes, right? So they had to like kind of make them look like werewolves. And Christopher Lee goes, because he plays a werewolf expert, he goes, oh, I got it. What I'll do is I'll say something about at some point in the evolution, werewolves go through a monkey phase. And he says that line in the movie, right? And when he says it, you're like, oh, that makes sense. And then if you think about it for even a second, you're like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. And I cannot believe it's in this movie.
Just sitting in his trailer going, we have to make this make sense.
We can't ship him back.
Fill in the gap.
He's like, oh, I got it. Monkey face.
You're a genius. It's interesting to see Boris Karloff, you know, with the mustache, owning the mustache, and enjoying being human.
Oh, yeah.
And this, and it is a fun show to see him piece stuff together. He has a certain credibility on screen. But
have
I
you seen Target?
Rushing to see it.
The John Frankenheimer movie?
No.
So it's Boris Karloff, maybe 1970, and it's a really great movie. It might be my favorite acting that I've ever seen him do. Really great movie.
I love when they're just acting.
And he's just, and it's not, doesn't play on his, like his, you know, his persona. It's just, it's great. Not enough people have seen Targets. So where are we, Friday?
We're at Friday. I went very Canadian, 8 p.m. As much as I wanted to watch the Ed Sullivan Show, it had me. And then I was like, no, I got to go with Wayne and Schuster.
Yes.
And are you familiar with Wayne and Schuster?
I am. So they were a Canadian comedy duo, right?
Yes.
I think Lorne Michaels wrote for them or he worked on their show.
Yeah. True to like Canadian entertainment, they will neglect 80% of the entertainers and then just give all their money and shows to like a handful of people.
Right.
And this is, they're a perfect example of it. I never found them funny. I never found them good performers or engaging people. They would always do humor that was, you know, Canadian humor, especially at that time, they always say it's like an echo of British comedy.
Right.
Because obviously. So it'd always be literate.
Okay. So it's not even like Peter Cook and Dudley Moore kind of hip. It's like.
No. They would do like Julius Caesar parodies.
Okay.
But when they would do parodies, like The Hour would be a Julius Caesar parody.
Which SCTV would do, but in a much better way.
Yeah, I mean, they would parody it kind of true to the genre, but they would be parodying, you know, books.
Right.
So you're like, and they would do these songs that were never really funny. And I'm very forgiving and sympathetic to, you know, things should be funny in their time.
Yeah, humor doesn't age well for the most part. It's very time and place, but that sounds like it's comedy by like the man.
Yes. Oh my God. Very, very much. And the one like modern connection is that, you know, when Norm Macdonald had that Netflix show?
Yes.
He would sing a song at the end. I could see by the clock on the wall. That song, that song is the goodbye song from Wayne and Schuster.
Okay. So he clearly had some affinity for that from when he was a kid. But it sounds like what you've described to me sounds like if you were in high school and they had a talent show and the teachers would do a sketch, that's what it sounds like.
Yes. Yes. It's exactly what it is. And especially for a comedy duo, they had no, to me, discernible differences. Like, that's one was a little wackier.
Right.
But not enough. Not an Abbott and Costello where you go, he's this guy and he's that guy. Right. They were just both kind of, you know, whatever. But Canadian. That's the most Canadian, like, the fact that they were successful, I think, says a lot about the country.
Did you ever get into Bob and Ray?
I didn't get into them because a lot of their stuff was that radio, and I knew they did that wonderful with the SNL. They had Lorraine Newman, Bob Lay, and Gilda Bob Radner.
Which is hilarious. It's funnier than what SNL was doing at that time.
And I think they did one with the SCTV cast too.
That would make sense. I've not seen
If I'm not mistaken.
But it's Chris Elliott's dad, Bob Elliott.
Yes.
And they kind of got there around 56, 57. They were kind of doing – that's who I think of when I think of, like, good two-man acts that aren't holdovers from vaudeville.
Right. No, these were very vaudeville, like wearing tuxedos, you know, that kind of – they weren't out to really take anything down.
Right. They had no point of view. They were just like, this is the stuff we're doing, whatever.
Yeah. But I mean, I'll probably, now that I feel bad, I'm going to probably go watch some to like atone for it.
Which is very Canadian. You
know? Very Canadian. So that is absolutely an hour long. There's no way it's not an hour long because Wayne and Schuster will test your patience. So at 9 p.m., I picked Crusader. Because I liked how this sounds. The episode is called Blackmail. A young Polish physicist hides as a janitor in West Berlin. When Matt Anders learns that the young man whose training would be valuable to communist countries has become the victim of a kidnapping scheme, he tries to help. Brian Keith, I love this old phrase, is starred as Matt Anders. And then the kicker, our reviewer goes behind the Iron Curtain in next week's TV Guide.
I'm curious if that's like writing about Soviet television or not. Because TV Guide in the 80s and 70s did do a lot of articles about Soviet television, which are fascinating. Yeah. I'd be really fascinated to read one set, you know, from 56. I have no idea.
It's really like. And I mean, I know a lot of people now talk about the fall of journalism, but here it looks like they had so much journalistic credibility that even TV Guide wanted to tackle, you know?
Oh, yeah. Well, they would write like pretty in-depth articles about, there's a lot of futurist stuff, a lot of stuff about technology. There's a lot of really fascinating articles about the terrifying influence of television on politics that even as far back as the 50s, you're reading some of this stuff and you're like, people should have read this. It's interesting. It's not a rumor mag. It's not like Us Weekly. No. Like there probably is an interesting article there. That reminds me, there's a movie called Who. We're not going to get Abbott and Costello here, but for some reason that show description reminds me. And this movie is based on a book. It's from, I think, late 60s, and it stars Elliot Gould. And I saw this movie late night on TV as a kid, and it haunted me. And the plot is this Soviet scientist gets blown up. American nuclear scientist, and gets blown up like on the border of East and West Germany, right? And the Russians send him back, but he's got his head is now like encased in a metal mask, and he's got metal hands. And they're like, no, this is him, but like he got blown up and we fixed him, but this is him. But they're like, is it him? Like he doesn't have fingerprints, and like we don't know his face. So this whole movie's like this weird paranoid rumination on like what makes you you. And it's this super weird, the twist in the movie is different from the book, but in the movie, it's so much darker in that it turns out it was him the whole time. And he is like this brilliant scientist who could have come up with all the stuff that would have basically led to world peace. But he gets so fed up with this, like, who is he thing that he just goes and becomes a farmer.
Great.
And it's like the last shot is him just this metal face and mask, just like tilling soil.
In peace.
Yeah.
Finally at peace.
And it's great. It's great. It's really good movie, but not a lot of people have seen it.
That's fantastic. So those are my picks, but there are a couple of other articles I would like to bring up.
For sure.
It's okay. Page 13 is the Lawrence Welk feature article titled A Good Time for Mother.
Which we heard him mention.
Yeah. I think it's safe to say, you know, Lawrence Welk was really the MILF hunter. I think that was his
It says how old he is. He was 52 here. Jesus Christ. What? 52.
And he's, I mean, when would you put a 52-year-old on television now as a debut? Are you kidding me?
TV's newest sensation, 52-year-old Lawrence Welk.
In that sense, I think we'd have to go back and apologize and say he looks young.
He does look young for 52. You're right.
He's also standing in the first image next to an incredibly tall, lanky man.
Yes. Yes.
It's very disturbing. And below the bottom image, there's he's looking over Myron Florin's shoulder. So that's Myron Florin there, which is such a great Lawrence Welk name. You know,
Myron Florin.
Myron Florin.
It's like, a great name to say if you're doing a Jerry Lewis impression.
Yes, absolutely. Myron Florin.
Florin.
And so there's, you know, it's so great how he's like explicitly branded himself.
Yeah.
Like, he's not hiding it. They're making it really clear what the deal is here. And then on page 16, it's an article entitled, Who's Afraid of Television?
Before we get to that for 1 second, can I just read this excerpt from this Lawrence Welk article? Because it is astounding. It says, invalids come in wheelchairs to quote-unquote dance to his music at the Aragon Ballroom in Ocean Park, California. On a recent personal appearance, Welk packed... 32,314 paying customers into an abandoned California blimp hangar. Unabashedly, a Santa Monica physician scribbles, quote, champagne music on his prescription pads, hands them to people who don't feel so good anymore. An estimated 85,000 dues-paying members enrolled in the 11 separate fan clubs of the Lawrence Welk Orchestra faithfully write Welk and his band some 3,000 letters a week. This whole article is filled with crazy stuff like that.
It was written by a relative of Rick Rude.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Invalids
come in wheelchairs to dance. I'm just picturing this poor kid in a wheelchair and some doctor writes him a prescription for champagne music.
Got to think about how many people have died on a prescription of champagne music. How many people with legitimate mental health issues
were basically denied
by their doctors? Oh, my God. And then the blimp hangar. Imagine him just going, well, we can do it here.
You have any abandoned blimp hangars for my 32,000 fans?
And then, you know, true to the article, there's an incredible picture.
Oh, yeah.
Welk in the middle of, and it looks like they're there to see the Pope. Like, that's how packed in these people are.
They are packed. And I do like that this article also mentions Xavier Cugat, who's maybe my favorite band leader ever.
Fun story. At one point, at kind of as a lark, David Arquette tried to set me up with Charo. It did not work.
Cugat's guitar player.
She was Cugat's first wife.
Oh, I didn't know they were married. Okay.
Yes. And apparently he was not
a nightmare.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm not surprised.
Desi Arnaz also worked for Cugat. He was like his first band leader boss. And he said Cugat was very cheap.
I bet.
He says it on The Tonight Show. Yes, on Carson. He was like, oh, he's very cheap and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, David, as another birthday present, I think maybe a year later, we get each other odd gifts, got me a painting by Xavier Cugat.
That's amazing.
Yep.
Oh, man. I would love to see that.
So I have it hanging in my bedroom. I have a Cugat.
Yes. I will say Cugat's music is fantastic. Of all this big band stuff, it's got a weird edge to it that the other stuff doesn't have. It's not quite Martin Denny Exotica. It's got like, it's a whole other thing. And Charo was a classical. It is an amazing classical guitar player and played guitar on a lot of his stuff. That's, man.
And there's no, and he's another example, just no bad musicians then, like perfectionists. No. This is all they had to do, obviously. So they were just like on it.
Yeah. And people didn't have really a lot of other stuff to do except practice all day. So it was like, you just get really good.
Yes. So page 16, the title is Who's Afraid of Television?
Yes.
And this is back in the day when film stars and theater actors would be looking down at being on television.
Yeah, it was either at the start of your career or at the end of your career you did television.
Yes.
But which was true up until 20 years ago. I think with streaming and sort of in a post-Sopranos yes. world, there's sort of no delineation anymore.
Yes. And it's just so weird to me that in 1956, like, the actors are that explicit about that. You know, that there's an article about it.
Well, I mean, the studio system, like the movie Hollywood studio system was still in full glam mode, and TV was seen as almost like a blue collar profession. Like, you know, you're working every week, like, and actually one of the big stars that kind of made that a little bit less, was Fred McMurray, who had them create My Three Sons, 'cause he wanted to go on vacation in the summer. So he would have them shoot, just, and he had a regular gig, but he was a huge movie star. This article also anchors around Jane Wyman, who is Ron Reagan's first wife.
Very bizarre. It's just, oh my God. Oh, you just forget that these people existed.
Oh yeah.
Then, you know what I mean? Like, oh, they existed on like a daily basis.
Yeah. And she's like 20 years old. Like, right. It's just weird. Oh my God. I hope you mentioned the review on the next page.
The Wide Wide World? Is that what we're talking about? Oh, no. You're talking about Wanted.
Wanted. And mostly because of the photo that is incorporated in Wanted of the narrator of the show.
Yes. Whose mustache looks like his nose is wearing dress shoes.
It's the weirdest thing I've ever seen. It looks like he got caught in the middle of doing snuff. Like, I'm sorry, you're taking a picture?
Yeah. It's the, because what was available was, you know, certainly by this point, Hitler mustache is the Hitler mustache.
You can't do it.
So he just shaved a patch in the middle of it.
He goes, well, I'm not getting rid of my mustache completely because of that asshole.
Yeah. No, he said, I'm keeping it. I like how it shapes my face.
It just looks like long nose hair.
Yes. It's absolutely terrible. Just serious. Of course, he's a serious person.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
You know, of course, and he's a narrator.
Big, like glasses, like this. He's not like a fun, like if Errol Flynn had that mustache, maybe he could pull it off.
Yeah.
Not this guy.
This is not doing it. So, no, the one that caught my eye was now, but it's called Whatever Below That, Whatever Happened To.
Oh, yes.
For a number of reasons. One, even the very title gives me anxiety. Yeah. That there's pressure on these poor people. Like, if you're not on television, people think your career is over.
Of course.
You know? And these poor actors, all of them are really successful. I mean, the first picture is Tony Randall.
Tony Randall. And then it said, still acting.
Like, what? They thought I wasn't there. What? You know, Tony, we should clarify that you're still around. Like, oh, Tony, we thought you died. And this is before everything, before Odd Couple, before my favorite horrible movie, The Seven Faces of Dr. Lowe.
Yes. And he puts in quite a lot of acting in that movie.
The most acting ever.
He starred in.
Oh my God. This is a weird, I don't know if there's a term for it. And I don't mean to excuse it or glorify it, it's just as bad, but there's a good-natured racism where he thinks he's doing justice to the ethnicity. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, he's not playing it for, it's not Mickey Rooney.
Right,
he's playing it as like an esteemed character, like he's acting up somehow.
Yes, I'm not excusing it. I'm not saying it's okay.
I know
I'm
what just you mean, saying, though.
Yes, he came from a good place.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I mean, I love Tony Randall. It's so weird to see him young here, and then people think he's finished.
It's slightly above Joel Grey in Remo Williams.
Yes. Yes. Fair enough. I'll take that. Also here is Red Buttons.
Yep.
Who was on TV mainly on the Dean Martin roasts, like, forever after this.
Yep.
But here he is, I think, totally unrecognizable. He still has really a full head of hair, which is a different color. Yeah, it's very weird. And they just said, nightclubs. He's doing the clubs. Like, it's so, like, literally, this article is a definition of out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah.
Oh, and Ray Bulger, who's also, like, none of these people, their careers were not over.
I guess if you think about it, so Ray Bulger, who's from Boston, by the way, which is why him and Jack Haley, the Tin Man, had wonderful Boston accents in that movie. Yes. And when they have scenes together, they get worse as they go back and forth, which is my favorite, my hot. And in Dorchester, Mass., there's a mural of Ray Bulger on the side of one of the buildings there, which is hilarious. But yeah, this is almost 20 years after Wizard of Oz. So they're probably like, mm-hmm. whatever happened to that guy?
Yeah. Yeah, and also mentioned one line is Mickey Rooney. Mickey Rooney has been playing top nightclubs.
What the hell kind of act did Mickey Rooney do in a nightclub? Would he sing? Like, what the hell?
He must have sung and danced, and I can't see him being that good of a singer or that good of a dancer, to be honest with you.
No. I never got Mickey Rooney. I never really understood.
Well, I mean, he was that child star. He had almost an early Mason Reese quality.
A real Mason Reese vibe. Have you ever seen the movie Silent Night, Deadly Night, Part 4, The Toymaker?
Not Part 4.
Part 5, rather. It stars an evil Mickey Rooney.
Oh, God.
Who makes toys that kill children.
What a weird person.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Miss McDonald, this is the last thing here. Is that her name? Kyle McDonald.
Yes.
Is playing nightclubs and looking for a new TV show. So I guess like the writer would just call up these people's agents.
Yeah. What have you guys been doing? Is the person dead?
What's going on here?
Well, this one, Roberta Quinlan. Well, Miss Quinlan, now married, is living in Rochester, New York, and appears on telethons occasionally.
Thanks. And then... The final one of the final articles in here is Confidentially by Earl Wilson.
This is the rumor mill.
Yes. And this is my favorite paragraph, if I may be so bold as to.
Oh, yes, please.
When Jackie Gleason was ordered into a hospital for an operation to remove a cyst from his stomach, the doctor said, "It's nothing. It'll just be a snip, snip, snip." And Gleason replied, "That's right. At $1,000 a snip." So these aren't true.
No, that's like Jackie Gleason being like, "Hey, you know what'll make me look cool."
Is it Jackie Gleason like calling up or publicizing this, or is it Earl Wilson just saying,
just making it up?
Yeah.
I'm wondering if Jackie Gleason went into the hospital for an operation for like something from being a booze hound. And then like, this is some kind of weird preemptive spin. Like Jackie Gleason, who I could talk about forever and I won't because I've been taking up your whole night, but is a person who, again, never heard a good thing about. By all accounts, bad guy. Stole tons of stuff from people. His whole Jackie Gleason orchestra, he literally had nothing to do with it, but basically all those musicians just paid him for his name. He strong-armed people. I find him so goddamn likable and love watching him in anything I can see. And I hate that. Like I love the movie The Toy, and I don't want to love the movie The Toy with Richard Pryor. But I had Teresa Ganzel on the show, who's in The Toy with him. And they were filming that in, I think in Atlanta or somewhere outside of Hollywood. It was like a place that was doing like, giving credits. So like North Carolina or something. And, Gleason wasn't staying in the hotel with everybody. He was in a different hotel, and they were all in like a Holiday Inn. And she's like, "Oh, he's probably staying at like this fancy hotel because he's Jackie Gleason." And he invited her to his room one day at this hotel. And she goes, and the reason he was at the different hotel was because it was the tallest hotel in the city. And he had his telescopes all set up so we could look for aliens. He was obsessed.
Could you imagine that just informing the front desk? Mr. Gleason would be arriving with his telescopes.
He'll be looking
for
aliens.
They need to be carried up. Yeah, please do not disturb Mr. Gleason while he's looking for aliens.
He swore up and down that Nixon showed him dead aliens. Like he...
Unbelievable. Totally believable, but...
I believe it. Rich Little could have done that sketch. Oh,
yes. Jack. Why was that?
Could have played both parts. I'm Jackie Gleason. Away we go. Here's some aliens.
Now, also on this page, I must read one ad.
Yes,
because
please.
This was still in the era of these drugs might help you. They might kill you. This is called Goody, 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 Daddy's Home, even after a tough day at work. Breadwinning worries sometimes leave you less than fun to be with when you get home. No wonder you feel impatient and restless. That's when Miles Nervine can be such a help. You don't want something to make you listless. You want Miles Nervine. It simply relaxes you, soothes your nerves, helps keep you good-natured. Follow the label, avoid excessive use. Buy a Miles Nervine, effervescent tablets or liquid at your drugstore.
I don't know if you've already looked this up, but I'm looking up what was in Miles Nervine.
What was it?
It's just Alka-Seltzer. It's sodium bromide and potassium bromide with sodium bicarbonate and citric acid. So it's just Alka-Seltzer. But I'm like, oh my God, this is hilarious. So there's actually a CBC radio story about Dr. Miles Nervine, and it lists all the things that it said that it was good for. And again, people, this is just Alka-Seltzer, literally Alka-Seltzer. And it said it was good for nervous exhaustion, sleeplessness, hysteria, headaches, neuralgia, back pain, epilepsy.
Oh, God.
I guess a little bit better than getting a prescription for champagne music, but not much better.
These poor people just had, some of them had gas.
Yes.
Right? And so this was very helpful. But then these poor epileptics.
Take some Nervine, you'll be fine. I'm kind of relieved. I thought it would be like cocaine or like morphine.
Yes.
But, you know, that's almost cute at that point that it's just Alka-Seltzer. Yes. Best Absolutely. Case scenario, it's placebo.
Yes.
It's
the
radium.
Champagne music of yeah.
Just take some uranium, it's fine. Well, thank you for doing this. This has been a match made in heaven. What a good time. We'll have to do this again.
Please.
Yes.
I will try to pick something from this century.
You don't have to. That's the beauty. We don't get to do a lot of 50s issues because, frankly, you know, not everyone is in their mid-70s like you are no. and is able to utilize the technology required to discuss these things. Yes. So it really worked out.
Thank you. This was an honor. This was such a delight to mention you. The Gentle Maniacs.
Yes, the Gentle Maniacs finally getting their due.
Yes, I'm satisfied now.
That was RJ, amazing guy. Also, my voice sounds weird. I'm nasally. You may have heard me sniffling in the episode. I did my best to stop. I heard it when I was editing it, and I hated myself. These allergies are killing me. I've taken several COVID tests. It's not COVID, but I apologize if that annoyed you, because it certainly annoyed me. But I tend to annoy myself more than I annoy other people, which I guess is good. Anyway, what a good dude. I had such a good time having him on the show. So thanks to RJ. Check out all his stuff. As I said, I put links to all his things in the social media and in the description of this show. And I had a good time. So I think you did too. I know you did. I know you did. You don't have to even say it. I can just tell. We have a brand new episode next week. So I hope to see you then for that brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
They just give him a live mic, and then he sings Ethel Mirman and gets booed. This somehow makes sense now. So I don't want to give the impression that I'm just angry and oily.